Hey everyone, on behalf of the scientists in every Florida school program, welcome. In today's science segment, we are joined by scientist Madison Flint, who will tell us all about minerals. So Madison, before we jump into minerals, can you tell us a little bit about yourself? What is your role? What do you research? And why is all that important?
Absolutely. So I am a graduate PhD candidate here at the University of Florida Geological Sciences Department. And my work is a little bit between subjects. I study not only water, so hydrology, but I also study the interactions of water with rock, so mineralogy, as well as the interactions with life, so biology. So theoretically, I'm a hydrogeobiochemist, because I am also a chemist in training. But I study the health of aquatic ecosystems, in particular the Floridan aquifer system. And I study the transport and fate of nutrients, as well as the production of greenhouse gases. As you guys may know, global warming is a real threat, and greenhouse gases actively contribute to that. And so I'm trying to understand some of the environmental controls on nutrient transport and greenhouse gas evolution.
Well, it sounds like all that must keep you very busy. So I'll thank you for all the work that you do. Moving on, can you please help us identify the physical properties of common earth-forming minerals?
Absolutely. So there's a couple of physical properties that we utilize to distinguish different types of minerals. One of the more obvious ones is color. And so I have a couple of samples to show you guys today. And some minerals do not have such vibrant colors. They could be plain and colorless, such as this calcite crystal here. But some of them can have very brilliant colors that distinguish, such as this brilliant green of the malachite, which is a copper-based mineral, or the brilliant blue of a kyanite blade. Doesn't look very brilliant, but trust me, it is. And then also, yellow of sulfur. Another cool thing about this mineral, sulfur, is it smells like rotten eggs. So we also use our olfactory senses as well as our eyes to distinguish between minerals. Another physical property we utilize is something called hardness of the mineral. And so we use this, this is a hardness kit, and we use what's called the Mohs hardness scale. And so that's from 1 to 10, 1 being the softest, and the mineral that represents that is actually called talc. I have a sample here. It's so soft that I can actually scratch it with my fingernail. And 10 being the hardest is a diamond. So a diamond can scratch any other mineral. So what we have here is a set of different types of metals and material that we can scratch to see the hardness. As you can see here, this one is a 9. And so from about 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, those are all different types of metals. But on the softer side, we have copper and acrylic to scratch too. So these are all different types of material that have different hardness that we can use to test the hardness of the minerals. And another one that's pretty easy to use is glass, which has a hardness of about 5.5. So color, hardness. Another thing that we use to distinguish is what we call luster, which can be broadly defined into metallic and non-metallic. So I'm going to show you a couple of metallic minerals right now. So here is a pyrite, very metallic luster. We've also got a galena sample here. Okay, and these are all the metallic. Now this one's a little less brilliant, but this is also metallic hematite. And you guys see that really cool like globular crystal habit. We'll get to that in a second, but that's also a very unique physical property of how the crystal grows. And then just a couple others. We've got magnetite here, which actually has, as the name may suggest, magnetic properties. And then we also have graphite. So this is actually very light compared to the other ones, but it is metallic luster. Okay, so then there's also non-metallic. And some of the non-metallic lusters are, as you've seen, I showed you the talc, which is the softest mineral. This has a very waxy luster in it. It's kind of hard to see, but the luster is how light interacts with the surface of minerals. And so this is a very waxy, greasy luster compared to, say, the luster of a selenite, This is a very silky luster. You can kind of see the light playing with it a little bit. Let's see. There we go. So this is a silky luster versus the waxy, greasy luster of talc. And then there's some other lusters too. There's what we call vitreous to subvitreous. This is a quartz chunk, and this is definitely subvitreous. And also something we call earthy, which this is a chunk of kaolinite clay. You can see there's no real luster. This is a very earthy luster here, so it doesn't really have much refraction of light. Okay. Oh, and also, sorry. So the silky luster of the selenite, and this is what we call a pearly luster of a mica flake. This is a flake of a mica. And so that kind of helps me transition into the crystal habit, which is the last physical property I wanted to talk about. And so this is how the mineral grows in nature. And so here is a huge chunk of mica. And so this is that pearly luster of the mica flake. And so you can kind of see close up the mica. This is a micaceous crystal habit because it grows in plates. Very characteristic to micas. There's also some other really cool crystal habits. This is a globular crystal habit, kind of like that hematite I showed earlier. And so you can see it forms in globs of minerals. And so we call this globular crystal habit. Also, granular is very common for many minerals. You can see this is a giant chunk of olivine just composed of small grains. This is a massive granular habit. We can also have very small crystals that form. These are, I believe, vivianite crystals. And so do you see how very, very small these are? This is what we call druzy appearance. So it's very, very teeny tiny crystals that form. We can also have basically no crystal habit where we just have masses. This is a mass of rose quartz. And then we can also have others that are pretty cool, like prismatic, where you can really see that internal crystal structure come out in the macroscopic. This is a prismatic crystal of smoky quartz. And then we can also have really cool ones like fibrous crystal habit. And so this is a chunk of a serpentine type mineral. And so I'm going to show you guys how fibrous is. It's literally produced of little fibers like hair. So pretty cool. And we can use these physical properties to distinguish minerals on the macroscopic scale. one more to show you guys, sorry. There's also, this one's pretty common. It's called bladed. It's kind of hard to see because those blades are also black and the rock they're in is also black. But if you can see these like very thin slices of blades, that's the mineral. And this is a bladed crystal habit. And I lied. One last physical property to cover is something we call cleavage. And so cleavage is dictated by the internal crystalline structure of a mineral. And basically, minerals break along the weak planes of the crystallographic structure. And so they break at certain angles, and these angles can tell us about what type of mineral it is. So I wanted to show you just briefly. If you guys can see, this is a little piece of calcite, and you can see it's not perfectly square. We actually have angles here of about 120 and 60, and that is dictated by the cleavage of the mineral. Versus something that looks very, very similar, this is a little piece of halite, so actually salt, sodium chloride. But you can see that the breakage is at 90 degree angles. So that's the cleavage of them. And they look very similar, right? Like if I looked at these and I didn't know any better, I would say, well, it's the same mineral. Nope, calcite, halite, and the cleavage helps distinguish. So another really cool physical property, kind of like the magnetism of the magnetite I showed you, a little bit less common to be utilized, but it's something called fluorescence. And so we talked about how minerals interact with light, with visible light, so the luster, the color, but also they can interact with other wavelengths of light. So this in particular is ultraviolet light. Certain metals that are in minerals can absorb ultraviolet light and re-emit them as energy in what we call fluorescence. So you guys may have seen fluorescing things before, but minerals actually have natural fluorescence when stimulated by UV.
All right, Madison. Well, thank you so much for sharing your expertise with us today and helping the science really come alive. And I want to take a moment to thank all of our viewers for watching this and taking the time to learn from us today. Thank you again, and we will see you next time. Goodbye, everyone.
Bye.